Macaulay James, the symbol of an iconoclast, his life and times.
My name is Dr. Yinka Ifele from Nigeria. I'm sending my condolences to the family of Asiwaju Basegun of Egbaland, Dr. Augustine Kayode Coley James, for his demise, especially to his loving wife, Irelu Robin Coley James. I pray that the Almighty God will be with the family, and also to the entire Yoruba community in Michigan and environs. I pray that the Lord in His infinite mercy will be with every one of us. Thank you.
Lowuro ojo ajinde tara tokan yo pade ekun kanu iro ra yo dope okan to kanu nisi to sin gbadura ki kan.
God Chosen Production, Adewale Dada the Good, presents Augustine Kayode Coley James, the symbol of an iconoclast, his life and times.
This world is not my home, I'm just a passing through. My treasures are laid up somewhere beyond the blue. The angels beckon me from heaven, open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Oh Lord, you know I have no friend like you. If heaven's not my home, then Lord, what will I do? The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. I have a loving mother just over in glory land, and I don't expect to stop until I shake her hand. She's waiting now for me in heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Oh Lord, you know I have no friend like you. If heaven's not my home, then Lord, what will I do? The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore.
For dust you are, and to dust shall you return. Genesis 3 verse 19. That was the commandment of the Lord to all mortals. So, Augustine Kayode Coley James obeyed the commandment of his Lord when he left this sinful world on Wednesday, March 24, 2010, to reign with our Lord Jesus Christ. Welcome to this special tribute. Augustine Kayode Coley James, the symbol of an iconoclast, his life and times. Dr. Augustine Kayode Coley James was by all standard a successful man. He found favor in the sight of God in his marriage and career. From the medical profession, where he was a factor, to politics, especially in Michigan, United States of America, and business, his imprints are simply indelible. Though Augustine was born into a wealthy home, as a young boy, his father made him hog water at Onikan Stadium, Lagos, Nigeria during football matches, and he worked in the factories under the supervision of his father's workers. All these, however, contributed immensely towards his success in life.
Yeah, I was born and raised in Lagos. At 12 at Bibok Street, Lagos. On May 4th, 1945. I did my elementary schooling at Holy Cross Catholic School. And then after that, I went to my secondary school at Oluwa College in Jabode. I think now it's called Adeola Odutola College in Jabode. After I finished my high school, I came to back to Lagos and did my A-level at Federal School of Science, Onikan. In Lagos, it was after that I went to Professor Ibadan and did a degree in physiology. I finished in Ibadan in 1970, June 70. And then after that, I proceeded to go to overseas in 1971. I attended Columbia University in 71 to 74, got a degree in pharmacy, bachelor's degree. Then I got a professional scholarship to go to Wayne State University to do my doctorate in pharmacy, which I finished in December 76. Then I got admitted to medical school, came back to New York, State University of New York, Downstate Medical Center. In 77, I graduated with my MD degree in 81. And went back to Detroit, Michigan to do my specialty training in internal medicine at Detroit Medical Center. After that, I started practicing in the city. At first, I worked for a hospital organization. After that, I worked for group practice. And then I started my own practice in 1977. Right now I have 5 multi-specialty practices in the city of Detroit and 1 specialty clinic. So I've been doing that since 87 to the present. And in 1996, I started another business, the Health Maintenance Organization, HMO. And currently, we're like the only African-American physician-owned HMO in the U.S. that I know of. So that's the story up to this point. My dad was a businessman. And incorporated that business skill in all of us. I have 5 brothers and 1 sister. And my mommy also was in the business. She was the cashier or accountant, if you will, for the company. So walked along with my dad. And so that's where the business sense came in. It's unusual most of the time to have a medical doctor with a good business sense, especially the way we train in the U.S. But because of the background I've had with my upbringing, my daddy was into a lot of businesses. He had movie theaters. He had hotels, restaurants. He transporting oils in barges. So it was in so many businesses. So all that I learned while I was growing up with him.
Augustine Colley James, an ambitious and passionate man, made up his mind to study medicine because he wanted to save lives.
My main purpose of going to the U.S. was to go to medical school. And the idea of being a medical doctor is something that's been on my mind since I was 10 years old, when I had a double pneumonia and almost died of it. And how that happened was that I was playing in the compound in the school. I fell and hit my chest on the rock. And they just dusted myself off. I thought it was something innocuous. I didn't say anything to my parents when I got home because I knew I would get spanked or whatever. But unfortunately for me, I must have injured myself. And it became very difficult to breathe. If I take a deep breath, my chest was hurting. So I was breathing so shallow. And physiologically, if you don't take a deep breath, the lungs collapse and the germs can grow. So eventually I developed pneumonia in both lungs to the point it got so bad. And by the time my parents realized it, took me to our family doctor. Unfortunately, he couldn't do much for me, and I was deteriorating. And it was a doctor, one young doctor that just finished at Dublin, Ireland, just came back at the General Hospital that took care of me. I had almost about 70 injections in my butt every day. I was getting injections until I was cured. While I was going through that treatment, and I visited this office every time, I got interested in reading, looking through all the medical books. And when I finally got cured, I said, wow, this is what I want to do, because if somebody could save my life like this, I wanted to do the same thing. Unfortunately, by the time I finished my A-level, there are only two medical schools in Nigeria at that time. And there were a lot of us in the 60s trying to get to medical school. And my dad was the type who won't use any long legs or anything to have any surgery. You have to do it on your own. I couldn't get in, so I decided after doing my physiology that I'll go to US to do medicine. Because I realized that in the U.S. you have to have a first degree before you get to medical school. But I was mistaken, because the British system of education is different from the American system. They do a general kind of first degree with physio, with liberal arts, social studies, and things like that. The British system I went through here, if you're in science, you do science, math, and things like that. So when I got to US, I was told that in order for me to get medical school, I have to do MCAT, which is Medical College Admission Test, which is in four parts: the science, math and English, social studies, and liberal arts. I didn't know anything about liberal arts or social studies. So they said, even if I scored high in those two other two areas and get zero in the other two, I don't have a chance. That time it's like 1 in 25 that applies to medical school gets in. On top of that, I was on a student visa. So you have to be a citizen, a permanent resident. So the odds were just against me. So they advised me to go to a community college, do 2 years to meet all these arts, liberal arts, social studies prerequisites before I can take that MCAT exam. But they told me my chances are still not any good. So I said, well, I'm not ready to waste another 2 years after all what I've been true, just going to have a chance. So I make a quick decision at that time that, well, I will get into some health-related field while I'm trying to meet all these requirements. And if I don't get into medical school, at least I'll have something to fall back on. So I chose to go to pharmacy school. Went to Columbia University, which was one of their Ivy League schools, applied. They wanted me, I showed them all my credentials, and they wanted me to take proficiency exams or whatever. So I was able to do that, and I passed out in most of the first 2 year things. So instead of doing my pharmacy degree in 5 years, I did it in 3 years. Because all the other science courses I took years and passed out of it. So I decided, well, instead of the 12, 14 credits for a full-time student, I was taking 20, 21, taking all these liberal arts and everything. So by the time I completed the 3 years, I've completed all those liberal arts and social studies. I've completed my pharmacy thing. I came second in the class, and I got a scholarship to go do my doctorate in pharmacy. So, but I still had the burning desire to do medicine, because that's my number one love. So after I did the MCAT, I passed well in those exams. So while I'm doing my doctorate, I took the exam and I applied to medical school. All the 5 schools I applied to admitted me. So I prefer New York because I'm used to New York as opposed to Detroit. So, but I was in between. So I decided to finish my doctorate in pharmacy, then went back to New York to do my medical school.
A deterministic Augustine, after training so hard in medicine, also devoted much time attending to patients because that was what he enjoyed doing most.
It's a lot of work. Even training in medicine is a lot of work. But when you're doing something you love, I heard somebody say, well, the best way not to feel you're doing anything is to do what you love. I can work seeing patients from morning till night or going to make rounds in the hospital. There was a time I was rounding in 7 hospitals, in ICU, people on critical care and everything, and they wake me up almost 5-6 times a night. But I enjoyed it. I never felt it was hard work. Unfortunately, lately, with so many bureaucratic things and regulations, it's taking the joy out of medicine. A lot of doctors feel like that, because we do more paperwork and different things rather than spending time with the patients. But regardless of that, I'm a family person. I love my family. I'm the type that I like to stay in, spend time with the family, do family outings, watch the news or whatever. I'm not an outgoing type of person, maybe because of the way I grew up, you know. But it makes it easy if you have a good wife, a good partner. The present Erelu is my second wife. My first wife of about 20 years, we got divorced because things were not just going right. But the Erelu, as you know, she's a nurse. She's got 2 degrees, master's in nursing and master's in business administration. We share a lot of things in common, a lot of things we have in common. So when you have that, it's just like you having a job that you love, it makes life so easy. Okay, and only the good Lord knows how it is, because if I'd known Erelu from beginning, oh gosh, we would have even gone much farther than where I am now. But God knows why.
We met in the hospital. Like I said, she's a nurse. Mercy Hospital in Detroit. So I was like the second top doctor in admissions or whatever. And she happens to be, if not one, the best head nurse. We doctors, we rely because she's the type, she enjoyed that job too. She knows everything about each patient on her floor. And I think their floor has about, I don't even remember, maybe 25, 30 or 40 beds and two people in it. She knows about every one of them. To the point that we doctors rely on her so much. If we have a patient that's really bad and we've made rounds, you just call and say, Robin, about my patient, Ms. Jones in room 245. She'll just tell you, well, the lab is coming back, it's this, it did this, I've done this, we want to do this. I mean, she's so good. So when we started, it was like a relationship made in heaven. And from then, she became nurse manager, and then she became, she left that and went to another hospital. It was the midnight director. And then when I started my health plan, I called her when I wanted to start herself and my accountant. I said, listen, I have this dream. I want to start HMO. They both volunteered many weeks, many months while we were putting these things together. That was in April 94 we started. We never got the certification until October 96. That's 2.5 years. And they just put things together. And then from then on, after a while, she was having some difficulty in the hospital. I said, listen, you don't need to go through all these changes. You can just come and work. Start working with me, and then we get married, and we start running the business together. And that's the way things have gone.
This Abeokuta-born, American-trained medical icon was undoubtedly a great ambassador of Nigeria. He was a board-certified internist. It is on record that Dr. Augustine Kayode Kola-James was the only Black American physician, HMO, and he owned 5 well-equipped clinics. Though he was not into partisan politics, Augustine Kola-James, through his wealth of experience on medical matters, was strongly connected to the who is who's in the political setup. His exemplary performance made the governor of Michigan to appoint him into several committees, which included Medical Liaison Committee and Quality Effectiveness Committee, among others. He has 2 male children, one of whom is now a dentist. Kola-James is married to Robin, one of the most beautiful women on earth. With an intimidating resume, Augustine, for over 4 decades, contributed immensely to the development of the United States of America, especially in the medical sector. And as much as he was doing that, he did not forget his roots. He was much concerned about healthcare system in Nigeria. He took steps at improving it. How far did he go?
That's a very touchy subject. I think every Nigerian, at least I can say most Nigerians that have gone abroad, at the time I went, it was with the impression to study something over there and come back home. And that was my intention. And well, my dad supported me through everything. And at the time I was finishing, I was asked to come on, which I did, to come and get the position here. I came, I think, in December, what year was that? December 80. He arranged, I went on interview at Luth, because I already had my doctorate in pharmacy and getting doctorate in medicine. I got a faculty position in those 2 colleges. So I went back to finish, pack all my stuff, and come home. That was the plan.
Unfortunately, when I got back to U.S., I think 2-3 days after that, in that December, there was a coup. And I never heard from the university sending me my papers to travel with or my letter of appointment, anything. And in those days, it's very difficult communication-wise. Telephone is difficult. I'm not too good at writing. I was too busy to be writing. We used to go weeks, months without communicating with people at home. So I waited so many months. June came, got through, waited January, February. Then I got a job at Henry Ford Hap. I signed a 2-year contract. Then in September, I got a letter from the Lagos University saying, well, now I can, they want me back and whatever. I said, listen, it's too late. I just signed a 2-year contract. So that's how I got stuck. Then with the hope that, well, maybe after the contract, I may come home, whatever. But with the military rule, things just got from bad to worse, to the point that at one point my parents said, well, stay where you are. And that's how I ended up staying, and then went from one thing to the other. But I was really unhappy with the state of affairs as far as healthcare is concerned. Because when I came for the interview at that time, even went to university teaching hospital in Ibadan, most of the wards are just empty, just beds, nothing. A lot of the doctors were finishing and coming to US, because I helped a lot of the Nigerian doctors, either helping them to get used to the American system, working in my clinics, giving them letter of recommendation, getting them into teaching programs. I did that a lot, I'm still doing that. And I saw it was a really poor state of affairs, and we needed real good help. But unfortunately, through all that military rule, nobody wanted to come home. And unfortunately, one of the major things that I said has become a touchy subject for me was that my father died in 89. It's going to be 20 years this year, and of medical condition that could have been taken care of. As you say, I deal with a lot of people in US, in the area where I'm at, which are poor areas. People don't have insurance, people have low insurance, low whatever. I take care of all these people. And to find my father die, yeah, without getting good health care, that has been a sore point. Took me a long time before I forgave myself. And so it's always been my desire to help do something about the healthcare in this country. And that's why now I'm doing the best I can, trying to penetrate and see what I can do to bring the state of healthcare here up a little bit.
On ProCare Health Plan Nigeria.
It's interesting. Things work so slowly here. I know I was involved with some of my friends who were trying to put things together initially many years ago to start some health insurance scheme here. And I was one of the people who first got the application and helped give them some of the know-hows. Unfortunately, because I was never on ground, didn't have anybody to really carry the ball, it took a long time before we could get things going on here. But I'm happy to say at this time that ProCare Health Plan of Nigeria is now certified. And unlike the other people who are just going with the ministries, getting the contracts, not doing anything, we really want to focus on the masses, who need the health care. And that's what we plan to do.
His goal and aspiration.
I've been greatly honored by Alake to have been bestowed this award of chieftaincy. And I know with that comes a lot of responsibility. Yes, I have had visit to the health care services in Egbaland. And just like I mentioned, the one in Lagos and everywhere else, it needs a lot of help. And that's my aspiration and my goal, to use all the expertise I have acquired to help bring good health care to the people of Egbaland. And to that effect, I've had some programs that we are working on to that effect, to start making some headway in the healthcare of the people. The same thing is this Procare Nigeria Limited, Procare Plan Nigeria Limited, to give healthcare to poor folks, all the working people that don't have healthcare insurance, because health is wealth. I believe in that.
Was there a moment that could be regarded as the happiest in Dr. Augustine Kola James' lifetime?
I've had multiple ones. The latest one that stands in mind was when my first son got married. Oh gosh. If I had that $10 million, I was ready to spend every penny of it. It was a grand occasion. And, you know, I just finished dental school and I did this 1 year internship and set him up. He had a practice. He was working somewhere and he's got a practice in one of my offices. And that was the first marriage, and you know, I was very thrilled. Myself and my wife, we worked hard. I mean, that was it was the party of the year in Detroit. I was really happy about that.
Any sad moment?
Well, I think it was one of my experiences in the U.S. You know, a lot of people don't understand the American system. But I haven't stayed there for almost 40 years. You know, with all my doctorate degree, double doctorate degree, you're a second class citizen. And when things really come out, when comes down, they will let you know in uncertain time, in uncertain words, you know, that, well, you're a foreigner. Even kids who were just born right in your presence, that you train or whatever, people don't know that part about U.S. And one of my worst days was when I had to take the government to court for one of their practices. And they ruled against me, even though they were guilty. I just said, wow. You know, people talk about America. They have their own ways. That's all I must say.
Dr. Kayode Kola James also broadened the exposure of the Nigerian heritage. This was attested to by those who called the shots in the community where he lived in their letters to welcome His Royal Majesty Oba Adedotun Gbadebo on the occasion of the installation of Dr. Augustine Kayode Kola James as Ashiwaju Baashegun of Egbaland. The chieftaincy title of Baashegun is usually given to Egba sons and daughters who have contributed to healthcare delivery system in Egbaland. The first Baashegun of Egbaland was a Frenchman, Reverend Father J.M. Cocard. He was given the honor in 1895 because he built the first hospital in Nigeria known as Sacred Heart Hospital at Itesi in Abeokuta. The immediate past Baashegun of Egbaland was Dr. Adeoye Lambo, He was also a one-time Minister of Health in Nigeria. Dr. Augustine Kola James was therefore honored with the title Asiwaju Basegun, Leader of Doctors of Egbaland, by His Royal Majesty Oba Michael Adedotun Aremu Gbadebo for his contribution of renovating Sabo Health Center and providing the people of the area with potable water, while also putting plans in place for ProCare Health Plan Nigeria to improve and impact positively on the healthcare delivery system in Nigeria. Their installation was held in the Music Hall, Detroit, Michigan, on Sunday, 1st November 2009. These are comments from those who call the shots in the community where he lived. The mayor of Detroit wrote, "Your Royal Majesty, on behalf of the citizens of the city of Detroit, I welcome His Royal Majesty Oba Adedotun Aremu Gbadebo Okukeno IV, Alake and Paramount Ruler of Egbaland, to Detroit on Sunday, November 1, 2009, on the occasion of the Chieftaincy Coronation Ceremony of Dr. and Mrs. Augustine Kayode Kola James, as the titles of Asiwaju Basegun Egba and Irelu Asiwaju Basegun Egba are bestowed upon them. I am excited that you chose Detroit to host this noble event. Such events held in our city broaden the exposure of the Nigerian heritage and arts value to our community. I look forward to continuing the correlation between Africa, Nigeria in particular, and the United States. This relationship will positively impact our region by building social, cultural, and economic links. Again, the city of Detroit welcomes His Royal Majesty. Please take opportunity to experience and visit some of the unique landmarks our city offers. Accept my best wishes for an enjoyable event and continued success. Signed, Dave Bing, Mayor." Another letter from a member of Congress, Caroline C. Kilpatrick. "I would like to welcome His Royal Majesty Oba Adedotun Aremu Gbadebo Okukeno IV, Alake and Paramount Ruler of Egbaland, to the city of Detroit on Sunday, November 1, 2009. During your stay, I hope you'll have the opportunity to visit the jewels of our city and dine at some of our fine eating establishments. It is an honor to have you here for the Chieftaincy Coronation Ceremony of Dr. and Mrs. Augustine K. Kola James, as the titles of Asiwaju Basegun Egba and Irelu Asiwaju Basegun Egba are bestowed upon them. Their accomplishments, display of leadership, selfless contributions, and commitment to helping others hold great merit and praise in our community. I offer you both my sincere congratulations on your accomplishments. I wish you continued success towards your future contributions to society." Signed, Caroline C. Kilpatrick, Member of Congress. And from the Chairman, Detroit Caucus, Michigan House of Representatives, 5th District, comes this one to His Royal Majesty Oba Dr. Adedotun Aremu Gbadebo. "Welcome to the United States, the state of Michigan, and the city of Detroit. We are extremely pleased to host you for this celebratory occasion. Also, congratulations to Dr. Augustine Kola James and Mrs. Robin Kola James on attaining the title of chieftaincy. As chairman of the Detroit Caucus, the legislative delegation from Detroit in our state's capital, Lansing, I hope you enjoy your stay. Thank you for this opportunity, and please do not hesitate to call upon Detroit and its citizens in the future. Signed, Bert Johnson, State Representative, 5th District, Chairman, Detroit Caucus. As the new Ashiwaju Bashig of Egba Land, he was introduced to other chiefs and people of Egba Land by His Royal Majesty Oba Adedotun Aremu Gbadebo.
Mo fẹ́ fi dókítà olóyè Kọ́lé James ọmọ ẹ̀gbá àti erelú aṣíwájú bá a ṣègùn ẹ̀gbá tó jẹ́ ọmọ Amẹ́ríkà. Nígbà tí wọ́n wá sí Abẹ́òkúta, mo ní kọ́ mú wọn lọ sí ilé ìwòsàn tó wà ní Sábó. Ilé ìwòsàn Sábó ó jẹ́ ẹ̀kan tó ti ọ̀lójúlé gbà púpọ̀. Mo fẹ́ kọ́ rí kọ́ lè rí kan tó bá lè ṣe fún wa. Nígbà tó débẹ̀, ìyàwó wọn bèrè wípé ǹjẹ́ wọ́n ṣe ń bímọ ní hospital yìí. Wọ́n ní wọ́n ṣe bímọ tán láàárọ̀ ọjọ́ yẹn ó bá bú sẹ́kún. Pé nínú ebutu yìí náà ni wọ́n ṣe ń bímọ. Láti bẹ̀rẹ̀ wọ́n ti bẹ̀rẹ̀ iṣẹ́ lórí hospital yẹn. Ní bó ṣe wálé yìí, wọ́n ti náwó láti fẹ́ǹsì bẹ̀ láti túbẹ̀ ṣe. Wọ́n lè ti wá di ogun rẹpẹtẹ láti fi ṣe láti fó fún àwọn hospital yẹn. Wọ́n ti gbà pé iṣẹ́ àwọn rẹ̀. Hospital márùn-ún ni Dr. Kọ́lé James ní Detroit, Michigan, A lè lọ sí ìkọ́ni hospital yẹn. Gbogbo àwọn ará Michigan ni wọ́n ròyìn Dr. Jerry Wadiwa yìí. Ẹni tó ní insurance àti tí ó ní insurance gbogbo ọdún tọ́jú kò sẹ́ni tó dọ̀sùtù rẹ̀. Wọ́n yí padà pé o lè ní ìwòsàn. Ìyẹn lọ́lọ́ fi túbọ̀ ń gbogbo fún. Mo fẹ́ kí o kólẹ̀ káwé fún àwọn méjèèjì. America. Olorun se die ibi na o mo pe a o mo ni bio ugo ife te ni ku awon eyan yi Olorun na a je ki Olorun ma feran yin na awon ti na a ma ra lanu eh omo kun ni komo komo te bi awon ya won to ma fe no awon pa je won bi yin a jo wa la yo fun gbo omo yi wa duro wa di gba be lo ba bi o eh be si pa so me ka yi e do le bo ni
he's my senior brother. The brother between us is not my, he was not my immediate elder brother, but now he is my immediate elder brother because the brother between us passed on. So he's now my immediate elder brother. Well, he was always the favorite of the old folks, you know, our parents, because he was the bookworm of the family. Always got the best grades. So, and very soft-spoken, easygoing. You know, didn't give the parents any trouble like some of us did. So, you know, he was their beloved, but definitely very bright, right from when he was a kid. Yeah, you see, he's 8 years older than me, so we didn't igimujinos enu bachema solid Yoruba. You know, he had an older brother that they were like 1 or 2 years apart. They were much closer. I was a little closer to my late immediate brother because the gap. But then I knew him to be a very serious person, hardworking. But then we were in New York together. We were going to school in New York together. I was going to Pratt Institute. And he was at Columbia University. I think that was probably in the early 70s, 73 or something like that. And one thing that really, really got me, that was a Christmas. You know, I think he was doing his PhD in pharmacy at Columbia University at that time. And he was doing the Christmas, and I said, "Hey, bro, let's go party." And he said, "Oh, meet me at Downstate Medical," you know, and you would not believe this. So I went there, and this guy on Christmas was busy dissecting dead bodies while I was ready to go out to party. And I said, "Hey, you're on your own. You can be here. I'm going to the club," you know. So, I mean, we had, if you're a Yoruba person, you know that, I mean, 8 years gap is no joke. When we were kids, but as we grew older, then we got to, know each other better, you know. He advises you and whatever, and he's very soft-spoken, but very intelligent. Well, he is what you might say consumed by his passion for the medical profession. You know, I mean, it's very rare for you to see somebody that has gotten as far as he has done in pharmacy to a PhD level at an Ivy League school like Columbia, and then go back and become a medical doctor also. You know, and he has actually given his life practicing medicine and in the U.S. I mean, as of now, he's the only black in America that has his own HMO. I mean, the Nigerian system is now trying to start this health management organization and whatever, and it's been a practice in the U.S. for a long time, but mostly owned by whites, and he's the only black man in America that has his own HMO, so he's been in that profession, and now I am kind of glad that he has decided that he wants to start doing what we call backward integration, you know, having attained this height, and however he can go over there, he's now interested in coming back home and seeing what he can do for his own people, which is very, very commendable. Hey, more grease to your elbows, bro. You know, keep on going. At 65, you're still a young man. You know, maybe by the time you turn 90, 95, we can now sit down and reminisce over a good life. But put the same zeal that you put into your work and profession in the U.S., put the same over here, maybe a little bit more, because things are not quite as well defined back home here as they are in the U.S. But, you know, when the focus is there, when the personal, you know, conviction is there, you will see the light.
We lost this gentleman. Yes, he performed excellently. And if I said he performed excellently, what he was able to do between the U.S. and Abeokuta, it's been unprecedented. You know, considering the relationship between home and our people in abroad. If I said we lost him, I am re-echoing the comment of the Alake. When the Alake heard that he died, Alake was shocked. The entire Egba people were shocked when we heard it. The only thing we can say that we can say is the fact that we loved him, and God loved him most. We believe what he's been able to do for us here will remain indelible in our memory. And I can say categorically that the Egbas, through the Alake of Ubaland, will do whatever humanly possible to ensure that his family, both at home and the U.S., stayed intact. We will lend our support to whatever the family will be doing in the near future. We will forever remember him for the fact that in the history of a grand nation, this gentleman came up, refurbished the health center in Sabo, in Abeokuta, not local government, to an acceptable standard, and he delivered it to the community. All the things he mentioned that he would do to Abeokuta here, we pray God that his wife, Irelu, would carry out his promises when he was alive. Whatever she would need to carry out the promises of her husband, the Egbas, I'm sure, would cooperate with her. May his soul rest in perfect peace.
I think it was one of my experiences in the U.S. You know, a lot of people don't understand the American system. But I haven't stayed there for almost 40 years. You know, with all my doctorate degree, doctorate degree, you're a second-class citizen. And when things really come out, when comes down, they will let you know in uncertain time, in uncertain words, you know, that, well, you're a foreigner. Even kids who are just born right in your presence, that you train or whatever, people don't know that part about U.S. And one of my worst days was when I had to take the government to court for one of their practices. And they ruled against me, even though they were guilty. I just said, wow. You know, people talk about America, and they have their own ways. That's all I must say. Well, it's my prayer that the Almighty God will bless Egbaland, will bless the people of Egbaland, and will make them prosper in Jesus' name.
We want that to be over.
Every mortal must pay the last price, death. No matter how highly placed, committed, or religious, death is unequivocally sure. Coyote Collie James is gone, but will be remembered for his contributions to the growth of healthcare in Michigan, USA, and a bold step towards the improvement of healthcare system in the interest of the common man in Nigeria. Augustine is dead. Coyote is gone. But for deeds and legacies, Augustine Coyote Collie James lives forever. Good night, Augustine Coyote Collie James. Good night, Asiwaju Basegun of Egbaland.
Iku pagbe bi eni ti o le daro. Iku paluko bi eni ti o le kosun. Iku pa leke leke bi eni ti o le kefun. Asiwaju Basegun gbogbo ile egba. Augustine Coyote Collie James. Hey, opalambo ti oyinbo fo onigbanso o mari so akoni ti lo. Alaanu omo niyan, Augustine Coyote Collie James, atori eni ti o sun won se, to nfi tojo ojumo sere. Akoni ti lo, o di gbere. O darina ko ipade tun joju ala. Augustine Coyote Collie James o ara owo awon egba molisa bi omo agbongbo akala. Augustine Coyote Collie James ara owo owo eyin lomo owo olowo oduru omo ajife pe sere se beyin ni awon baba yin ni ara owo iranro awi menu kuro ni towo omo ladejo omo egba molisa bi agbongbo akala. Ma simi laya olugbala titi ojo adinde ma simi lese Jesu Christi oba Augustine Coyote Collie James unre erelu asiwaju ba asegun ile egba Robin Collie James nse lede leyin re Bimbola Martins loruko gbogbo ebi Collie James o nse lede leyin re egba National Association patapata won se lede leyin re Yoruba community won se lede leyin re Nigerian Foundation gbogbo won pata ni won se lede leyin akoni gbogbo ebi ara ojulumo patapata won se lede leyin akoni Da Silva ati gbogbo Yoruba community n se lede leyin re Alake gbogbo legba oba to bi aro ara ke majo majo meji majo gbaruba majo gba eko eru ni nsin ni eko ki isiniyan kabiyesi alaeluwa oba adedotun are mu gbadebo loruko gbogbo oba loruko gbogbo ojoye loruko gbogbo eniyan nle egba won se lede leyin re akoni to ti lo gbogbo awon to se lore pelu omi je ni won fi nse lede leyin re gbogbo awon ori to ti tun se o di gbere o Darinako ipade doju ala o Augustine Coyote Collie James asiwaju ba asegun gbogbo ile egba asiwaju ala lusa o di gbere o
a o padele ti o do tese angeli ti te to mo gara bi kristali lebaite olorun a o padele ti odo odo didan na